My name is Rachel Feigenbaum, and I am SVP Events Program Producer at the Advertising Research Foundation. We're thrilled to be here. So a little background on Women Analytics. We started this last year. It's an initiative really to evangelize female leadership and create an environment for co-mentoring and a way to come together and not necessarily do the usual, you know, presentations. A lot of it is about sharing personal journeys and perspectives. And so we're thrilled to be in Chicago with Women in Analytics for the very first time. And it's all relative, right? Because New York's downright balmy in comparison to here. But we are starting to do Women in Analytics 3 times a year. So you'll see us back in the Midwest next year, not necessarily in Chicago, but in the region. And we have an amazing program today, and we're excited. It is about, you know, work-life balance. Does technology help or hinder? There's different viewpoints. In fact, I was just talking to Law right before, and you really raised an interesting point, which said it's not necessarily work-life balance. Is it work-life integration? Or is there even such a thing? And everyone has a different viewpoint. Everyone comes at it a different way. Maybe there's some best practices, but that's what we're here to talk about. And these are today's speakers. In addition to the speakers, you see we have some table discussant leaders, and they'll be leading those discussions later on. So without further ado, I want to actually introduce Sangha Bey from Ogilvy, and we're just thrilled that Ogilvy has had us here at their space, their beautiful space, and of course, Kantar and Twitter as our year-long Women in Analytics sponsors.
We're extremely grateful, and we have wine to prove it in the back, and Growth Capitalist has a special cocktail at the end. So, Sangha, do you want to say a few words?
Thank you, and welcome, everyone. My name is Sangha Bey. I'm an associate director at NEO at Ogilvy. This is really exciting to have all these faces in here because human race essentially is 50-50 split between male and female, but essentially nowadays we're seeing a little bit of imbalance, and I think we are having this great event at a great timing because now we are having a little more light on gender equality, wage gaps, and a lot of other stuff. There has been a lot of researches going on in terms of women, you know, workspace balancing. Some of the few findings, I actually did a little study yesterday and found some interesting facts that researchers found females are paying a little more attention to various stuff. So to your earlier point, it's more about not about balancing, but also spreading your attention. Also, there are studies from outsiders' point of view, if females are appointed as leaders of an organization, they put a little more extensive looking glass in terms of their qualifications and how they're going to lead the organization. And then they tend to pay more attention to what they did as opposed to what they're going to do. So these are some of the stuff that's happening out there. So I'd be really excited to see what kind of interesting point of views we can bring to the table and think about what we can do in our day-to-day to make things better and more equal. Thank you.
Thank you. And with further ado, I'd love to introduce our first speaker. So this is our presentation about the life of digital mom. VP of Insights and Strategic Marketing, Media and Digital Practice at Kantar Millward Brown. She really focuses on understanding audience and industry trends and creating and taking the market to newest products and tools to enable marketers to better understand and connect with audiences. And I'm excited to introduce her.
Hi, everyone. My name is Julie Nichols. I want to start with telling you that I changed my presentation. So the topic originally was digital life of moms, and I want it to be a little bit broader than that because I think that there's a lot of work that needs to be done. And I don't think that moms and women are two distinct things, right? Many of us overlap. We have overlapping concerns, right? Many women want to be moms. Many moms are also women. There's a lot of overlap with this. And I think that the challenge is so big that we can't afford to look at this as two separate groups, right? If we look at the bigger term, the umbrella term, which is we are all women, then it becomes a little bit, even though the task is huge, we feel that there are other people working towards it with us. And so I want to start by grounding us in a quote. So if you look at the agenda today, you'll see
that a lot of this is about work-life balance, right? The different ways that we job craft, the different ways that we work on our commute, right? Work on digital, work on technology so that we can do our job, so that we can better do our job, right? So we can be better workers, we can contribute more, and that we can stay in this, right? Even when there's competing demands of family, parents, children, whatnot. And that can often be tough, right? I know there are probably many of you in the room this morning who caught a really early flight to come here. I suspect there's others of you who may have been up at like 1 a.m. editing an Excel or a PowerPoint. I'm a little bit guilty of that, though it wasn't this one. And we work hard, right? We work a lot. And it's important to think about why we're doing this, right? If the struggle is one that can be challenging, okay, so this is going to be my long time. I think it's important to have a sense of purpose, right? That's what ultimately animates us and compels us to work harder, to do a little bit more. So I wanted to start off with this quote. Now, I have to say, I think this is a little bit of a wishy-washy quote, but I want to read it because I think it often captures the essence of what are we doing and why are we doing that?
And I'll say this from the perspective, I've been doing this a little bit more than 15 years now, and I started in ad effectiveness work when ads were really bad, right? Really terrible pop-ups. One of the ads I did was that was hot dog flying across your screen and then blocking everything, right? And so you often wonder, why am I doing this, right? And that becomes sort of hard, right? To
see the bigger picture, but I think the bigger picture is important if we're going to play the challenging effort as we do. And so this quote, this is from Adam Brown, who I think many of you know, he's an expert in workers, persistence, and organization. He says, most of us can find meaning in any kind of work. We perceive ourselves to be of service, whether we realize this is our motivation or not. So when we think about advertising research, right, what does it mean to be of service, right? What does it mean to contribute something more, right? So we can help our clients. We can help people spend more efficiently. We can help others in our organization grow and build their careers. I think that there's something a little bit more than this if we're going to be honest about it. So rather than me tell you about it, I'm going to show you some ads. I don't have a perspective on it that I'm sharing just yet. Let me show the first one. This first ad. Anyone know what's being advertised in that ad? Show up, just yell it out.
American Apparel.
Any other guesses? Calvin Klein. Any other guesses?
Skincare.
Okay. Any other guesses?
Perfume.
Shoes, right. So this is actually what's being advertised in the ad. And the advertisers here, I blocked that, partly because I wanted to block the advertiser, partly also because my 7-year-old said, we're not going to show that at work. She's right. Let me show you one more like that, right? So this is an ad selling shoes. And for those of you who know a little bit about Stuart Weitzman, right? Gigi Hadid, I think, or Gigi Hadid, is not really in Stuart Weitzman's demographic, right? They're for more people who have spent a lot of time in high heels and more comfortable shoes, right? But this is the ad to convince you to buy the shoes, okay? So let's look at another one. Anyone seen this ad before? So I'm going to read it for those of you in the back. So the ad implies, advice to him, spike your best friend's eggnog when they're not looking. You can't really do that. It's kind of a legal action thing. Anyone want to guess who the, and this was the ad, I blocked out the brand again, but anyone want to guess who the advertiser is there? Take a few, just a few guesses, first thing that comes to mind. And if you can't guess the brand, just try to guess the industry.
Eggnog,
okay, one guess.
Rum.
Liquor.
Any other guesses?
Trump
Hotels. That one's ring next year, but yeah. Any other guesses?
Clothing.
Scarves. Men's clothing, women's clothing. Women's clothing, right? So the advertiser is Bloomingdale's, right? Who shops at Bloomingdale's? I shop at Bloomingdale's, right? Do I want someone spanking my drink? Probably not, right? This ad ran. Right? It wasn't until there was a big backlash on Twitter that this ad was pulled out. This last ad that I just showed you, naked people on a building wearing fairly ugly shoes, it wasn't even a backlash, right? We were so desensitized to it that it's like, what does this have to do with that, right? This, to me, when we talk about what is our purpose in all of the work we do, it's this,
right? If we're going to be really honest, how women are represented in advertising, whether we're talking about billboard advertising or magazine advertising or digital advertising, is not yet where it should be. And so while, yes, part of that challenge is how we depict moms, it's often how we depict all of us, right? And I think those of us who are in this industry are in a unique position that we have a role to change it, and we have a role to influence it. And so what I'd like to spend the rest of my presentation doing is, in addition, hoping to like just motivate you with a sense of purpose around it, is to actually give you some actionable guideposts of how I think that we get towards a day of not seeing ads that look like this, right? And if you're still not convinced that you think these ads are fine, let's take it from a different perspective, right? Let's start with the perspective of the audience. So in a study that was done by Saatchi & Saatchi about a year and a half ago, 50% of moms, and this was a global number, pretty consistent, right? U.S. consistent with global, 50% of moms felt that marketers didn't understand it, right? And I would suspect that this number is probably pretty similar to women, but we don't have that number, right? We're not tracking that number right now, so we don't have a sense of that. When we see ads that we just saw, I think it might be pretty consistent. So 50% of moms feel that marketers don't understand it. But we go to sort of the side of, I guess we want to stay on the side. Next slide. We look at, so what's the implication of this, right? If we look at the next slide here, what we're going to see is that about 70 to 80% of all purchases are either made by or influenced by women. And this is not just CPG, right? This is not just a decision about which brand paper towels I buy. It cuts across everything to financial, so, sorry, 85%. Cuts across everything from healthcare decisions, financial service decisions, to apparel decisions. So even if when you saw those last two ads, you felt like, wow, these ads are personally distasteful to me, right, because I was really sick between my values, there's a bigger side of this from a professional perspective of they're ineffective, they're not working, right? It means something for us to feel an affiliation with the advertiser there. It makes the brand more meaningful, it makes the brand more powerful, right? And when we show ads like this, we're not only alienating part of our audience, right? We're not connecting with them at all. Which is our biggest challenge. So we're really losing that, right? We're not just somewhat disgusted, but we're also ineffective. So I think when we start with talking about how do we chip away at this problem, how do we make ads that women are more receptive to, right? How do we make ads that moms are most receptive to? We have to start with some basic truths, right? Which is that when we buy shoes, which is what this is for, you don't have to admit it, but I suspect that many of us have been to a Burger King. In the past 12 months, I don't even want to talk about what this ad does because I don't think it's worth it, right? But I don't feel very good that I stopped at a Burger King on the side of 95 when this is the ad that was running, right? This is a digital ad. There was also a print variation of it. And then one might be the worst one because it's so subtle, right? And it's easy to walk past this, to look past this. And if you can't see this one, you can gather closer for a second. This is an ad for Post-its, which to me seems like a fairly innocuous thing. I have about 5 or 6 sets of them in my purse right now. Right, an ad for Post-its. There's a lot of ways we could advertise Post-its. Do we need to advertise it by having the woman have her name, right? This says Ashley, this is her name on the head, so that I think the implication here is that we need it at the bottom, right? That's to remember what this person's name, who's next to her. It says Post-its, right? Middle America, I'm a supply company. Right? So this is pervasive. It's not just all about Carl's Jr. hamburgers and Burger King, right? All the targets younger men, so we have to do this, right? It's sort of everywhere. And it really is up to us to begin to chip away at saying, we're not going to say it's not okay. We're going to say it's ineffective, right? It's a waste of advertising dollars. And it really does sort of pull down our industry when this is the type of stuff that still runs. And this ad was up in August, right? So as much as at the time we were, you know, had a woman running for president, we also have this all over the billboards of the talent challenge. Right? So what's our first principle in how we begin to chip away at this and do some different things? I think the first perception is really aligned with the perception of mothers and women, right? That it's not two separate groups, that it really is one group all sort of looking for the same thing. And then within that, remembering that if we influence 85% of the purchases, that includes shoes, that includes basketball. Right? So first concept. second concept is really sort of how we start to talk about digital and how we start to talk about what are the things we look at. And this is really, I'd say, more for making sure we're advertising in the right places, right? When we look at moms here, we see that, so you can't see this, sorry, it's dark here. What we see is that both moms with young children, moms with older children, they have more digital time, right? That's important for two reasons. It's important, one, because we want to reach them in the right place, just right when we're thinking about how do we create this better advertising that we air to them. But it's also important because it lets us personalize our message to them, so these type of terrible ads we can sort of avoid altogether, right? We also see that there's an opportunity with women that's a better opportunity than we have in the general population. So if you've been at any conference in the past 6 months, inevitably at least one of the topics has had one, how it's just this terrible thing for our industry. So TNS ran a study called Connected Life that they write every year. We looked at what's the rate of people that are planning to have one. It's 25%. It's actually better for women. Fewer women claim to use Adblock, right? And fewer women with children under the age of 6 claim to use Adblock. The implication of that is, right, we have what can be, with good content, a receptive audience if we don't screw it up, right? And we need to be asking those questions, looking at those data points, looking at the right things so that we have to do that. We see that across the board, right, women, particularly as those with younger children, are more receptive to brands. They read about brands, they use mobile apps, they visit mobile websites, right? So this group is a huge opportunity. This is just a point for younger women, right, and for moms where they're beginning to make the decisions about which brands they're going to become loyal to, right? There's a moment here where we can build relationships with them again, but again, this relies on that we are sending the brand communications, whether that's in the form of a website or a display ad, that are going to resonate with them. And same thing with social and video. We see that social and video in particular, whether it's reading brand posts on Facebook or commenting, or what I think is really actually one of the most important ones out here, which is watching video on Facebook and YouTube, that moms over-index with that as well. Right, so the finding of all of these slides together, in addition to giving you some data points on the digital life of moms, right, because that was one of my remits here, is also to show you that we have this incredibly receptive audience in terms of behavior, lack of other behaviors, lack of outlocking, if we can just show the right content, right? So the imperative here becomes how can we create the right content and how can we test the right content in a way that we can ensure those people have the right audience. So my second pillar on how we begin to chip away at never seeing out that Burger King ad that we saw is really asking the right questions about what moms, really women, are doing and what they're thinking so that we are sending them communications in the right places and the right ways for them to. So third concept is really about stories. You've probably heard a lot about stories, and I want to tell you why stories are so important. We've been measuring receptivity to advertising for years, and it's the core of the brand's business. And one of the things we do is we look at receptivity to all of the different kinds of brands. And we always struggle because the format for TV is a little bit less than 50%. And when we get into particularly our digital formats, right, in our video formats, which should be the most impactful, it often goes down, right? And we struggle with why is it going up? What do we do to improve that? We also have this narrative about Adblock. No one wants to see ads. I want to show you in here, that's not necessarily true. This idea that we just wholesale want to avoid ads is not the case, because what we see for the always like the Girl ad, the Pandora ad, and the P&G Thank You Mom ad, is that audiences seek out ads when the ads are unsubscribed, right? When they tell a story and there's high creating quality. So look at this first one, always like the Girl. I'm not going to show this one, so it's a great one to see. 27.8 million views on YouTube. And understand what that actually means for a second, right? What that means is that people are actively, proactively going onto YouTube, not just seeking out a video, they're seeking out an ad, right? So as much as we talk about everyone wants to escape from ads and block ads, in this case, 27.8 million times, we did not want to block ads, right? Similar with Pandora, 18.9 million views from Pandora collection. This is one we are going to look at. I know most of you have seen it, but I think it's so good it's worth seeing again. The P&G Thank You Mom, 22.2 million. Right, so you can say that these people, these viewers, are seeking out ads, But I think the deeper truth underneath that is that these people are seeking out stories. So let me show you what I mean. So I can show you the PNG ad. Right? You just kind of have it right on YouTube.
Sponsor of Moms.
Right? Usually not a dry eye in the house on that, right? You think about, so I've seen that ad, oh my gosh, I've seen that ad hundreds of times at this point. And every time I present it afterwards, I'm like, all right, let's go to the next slide. In fact, when I was writing through the presentation last night, my seven-year-old, who also gets teary with that, said, I think if you just show that ad, all the people over 41 will start to cry. So, guilty.
What that ad shows us, right, is not just the importance of stories, it shows us the importance of what good advertising can do, right?
And what really is our craft here. Let's go to the next slide, right? So, what's the third pillar of how we change, right? How we transform advertising for women? It's really advancing advertising depiction of women through well-told stories, right? The story is what resonates with us both from the characters in there as well as what it does for the brand. Okay, so three pillars down, right? And they all seem doable, right? I can ask the right questions. I can help my clients learn to tell stories better, right? I can share that women and moms are not so separate and that both of them actually go to Burger King, right? I want to be able to say to you that if you do those three pillars, it's enough. It's not. It's not enough, right? We can do our job as well as we can, right? I've been talking about how headless women in ads are not a good idea since about 2002. And it's really not enough. And I think it's not enough in part because we are swimming upstream, right? So when we think about how did any of that creative get out, right? How did that Post-its ad get out? Who approved that, right? What about the Gigi Hadid ad that we paid her millions of dollars to take off her clothes with other people that we could show on a billboard? Who approved that, right? We see that the challenge is that of all creative directors in the US, only about 11.5% of them are women, right? So chances are when these decisions are being made, there's a good chance that there's not a woman in the room at that table at all, right? So things that you and I might catch, there's no one with your perspective or my perspective or your perspective in that room, right? That's the first challenge. And when we think about what that means to research, we don't have any numbers on this. And I'll sort of pause at this point because I think one of the great things about the ARF that we could actually do, that we should actually do, is spend a little bit more time looking under the hood at this, right? It's nice to say that because we're an industry with a lot of women, right? And lots of women write reports, lots of women write surveys, right? At one level, there is parity. but if it, it all tracks sort of the direction that corporate America goes in, those gains start to go away. So this is in a study just recently released by McKinsey. The data is from 2015. And what they really looked at is the pipeline to reaching the sea level. And what it shows you, I want to go through these numbers a little bit, right? When we're looking at entry-level positions, we're fairly evenly divided between men and women. Men are about 54%, women are about 45%, right? We get to manager, it starts to go down, right? We start to see some differences here, 63% men, 37% women. Little difference at senior manager. We go to VP, right? Another, now we're almost at 3/4 male. We go to SVP, we are at 3/4 male. We go to C-suite, right? More than 80% male. So I think the question we have to be asking as women in research, where we have this amazing format to come together, should we be studying these issues a little bit more? Should we be understanding, right? First of all, is this the case for women in research or is it not the case, right? That's the first question. And we really don't know because we don't have data on this. If it is at all the case, why is that the case, right? I've interviewed lots of sort of young women who work with, they tell me all kinds of things that a woman and man can have exactly the same job. And when you say to them, what's the industry they're in? The woman will say, I'm in insights, and the man will say, I'm in data science, right? And we weight data science, like data science is harder, right? Data science takes more skills, right? And right off the bat, there's these basic assumptions that are happening. And this challenges us, right? Because the ability to really begin to influence things often doesn't happen here. It's great to think that I could share a report and say, why would we ever run that Burger King ad? That's terrible, right? At some level, I don't have that same pull as I do when I'm up here, right? When I have the seat at the table. And I would argue that women having more of a seat at the table, right, with our unique insights and ability to look at things from a more balanced perspective, also increases the seat of research at the table, right? The two things are mutually beneficial. Let's look at another data point on this, right? We saw this gap here from entry level to manager. This is another point from the same McKinsey study. So for every 100 women promoted to manager, right, women in orange here, about 130 men are promoted to manager, right? So right out the gate, just when we have that first moment of I am arriving, we are already not equal, right? Which brings us to our fourth point. I've played with the verb a lot here about whether it should be advocate for women's seat at the table. I had it originally as agitate. I think that a distinction is important, right? I want to say it's advocate. Wouldn't it be great? I think it is agitate, because to us in our head, asking that question of, wow, why are all of our directors men, right? Why that feels like, oh, I don't want to be that person who asks the question. I don't want to be the person who rocks the boat at all. But I think that advocating maybe hasn't been enough for us, right? I think we have to potentially advocate a little bit more because it benefits not just us, right? Not just the other women around us, but really how we depict women in our in advertising. So how do we do that, right? So if we're a more senior person, one of the things to start with, right, is thinking about, you know, our biases, right? How often do we treat men and women equally, right? We think we do, sometimes we don't. Sometimes, I mean, I don't, and I feel like I'm hyper aware of gender all the time, right? Are we pulling up men and women in the same way? Are we broadening the same opportunities? Have we gotten to a level where there's still another level and we just can't get past it, right? Beginning to advocate or agitate for those types of things, right? Looking for leadership, looking for mentorship, so that becomes less of a challenge. So what is the size of the prize, right, for getting all four of these pillars right? What happens when we can do all of these things? I think what happens when we can do all of these things is we produce better advertising. So I want to show you my last example, and I'm going to close on this example. And it's an example for Wells Fargo. So every time I say Wells Fargo, someone rolls their eyes and like, oh, Wells Fargo is totally screwed now, right? You know, all of the stuff that's happened with them. I think the person who developed this ad, she had nothing to do with it. And I say she had nothing to do with it because there's two things that are really important about this ad that I want to show you. The first is that it was extensively tested, right? From the point of wireframes, this is the concept we're testing all the way through. Is it the right actors? Is it the right music? We were thoughtful in making each of those decisions. And then the second thing is the whole concept for this ad down to who should we have in it was spearheaded by a female CMO. And I think you'll see why that's important in a second. So this is the last ad that I'm going to show of the day, and then I'm going to close after this ad. We can make this one bigger.
Everyone works hard for a reason. Working together, we can help you prepare financially for when two becomes three. Wells Fargo, together we'll go far.
That's the kind of ads we should be running, and that's the kind of ads we should be seeing. Thank you.
Leaving us on a teary note, okay. No, that's things. And, you know, afterwards we'll have some more time for discussion and questions. I'm sure some people might want to come and chat with you. And now I would just like to turn to our next presenter, who is, let's just go through the rest of this, Kate Serkin, Practice Lead Analytics and Insight Americas and Audience Insight globally at Publicis Media, and she's also an ARF board member. Very important. In fact, she's on our executive committee and has helped lead us and guide us and me personally, and I know I can speak on behalf of all of us. We're just very grateful for your help, navigating some waters right now and also being here and presenting. So let's give a big hand for Kate.
Okay, it's first to say, it's so exciting to see so many women here at this session. So thanks everybody for coming, and thanks for being part of the Insight and Analytics community in Chicago. It's a good group to have. I don't think we would feel as strong as individuals if we weren't all part of this group. I know when I go to meetings and I see lots of women in those meetings, it makes me feel proud of being in the industry and doing the work that we do. So I am going to talk for 10 minutes. Some of it might be a bit flippant. Some of it will be really honest and things that have helped me survive in my career for the last 29 years. I've worked for the same company, but with lots of different names and lots of different owners and some different countries and some different titles, but effectively it's been the same job. And my job, if I go back to the earlier speech, was what's my motivation for that job? It's been to try to be really clear about giving actionable advice from some kind of research, and that's to try and make a difference in a meeting. And I think if you looked at that pyramid that you showed earlier, you get the 46 and 37 and whatever it was. If one thing that we can do as a group is make sure whenever we do have a voice along here, our voice is more actionable and stronger and more sensible and more meaningful than the 60% that's at the top, I think we'll do a good service for both our industry and for our group as a community. And I would urge everybody to think like that. We sit in so many meetings where there's just so much discussion about nothing and politics and wasting time. And I know my view has been, get in quickly, say what's something that's meaningful, and then leave the meeting and have them all, kind of figure it out afterwards. So it's much more, I think women are more practical, and we can do that even from smaller numbers. We can make more of a difference, and I would urge you all to do that. And so I'll get on with my prepared sort of speech. I think the thing that we all need to realize as a mom, a wife, a woman, somebody in this industry, is it's not really, balance is a weird word. My experience is that it's not balance, it's tough. And you have to decide what it is you as a person want. I feel lucky that I've been in a company for a long time that's been, for a lot of the time run by some very strong women who have allowed me to do what I want to do. But I think there are many men who would allow many women to do what they want and what they need and what they're good at. So I don't think it's about necessarily having a good woman boss. It's about having somebody that understands the role that women can provide in a company. And you get that, there's the fluidity between, what's your home life and what's your work life. My daughter, she's 12, she sits in on conference calls that we have, our publicist trading organization conference calls at 8 o'clock on a Monday morning every week. She could tell you the CPMs across all of our preferred partners. She knows exactly how to use every single web meeting app on my phone, because she presses the buttons and she goes like this, press 0 for more information. If you want to go on mute, press #6 or whatever it might be. And she's involved in those conversations. So, there's a fluidity. If I'm driving her to school or I'm driving from ice skating, our time in the car, if I've got to be on a call, then she can be involved and she's actually listening to it and she actually finds some of them interesting. today she said, well, I have a Snapchat app, and do you think they want to talk to me? So she's engaging and understanding what I'm doing as a mom and as a career person. And I think that's kind of important as well. But the most important thing is to, you know, if you're in this business, to work for people and companies and in jobs where you can manage that balance to the degree that you want to. You can either be, in a position to make some decisions as you go through that career path about what you're going to do and how you're going to do it, or not. And if you're not able to do that in the company that you're with today, I would suggest you try to move to one that you can do that. I've been lucky for the most part. I've had some fights with some of my bosses, but I think I've always tried to stay firm and say, this is what I can do and this is what I can't do, and be honest and transparent about that. You know, they are in families and have, you know, challenges as well. So the more honest and transparent you can be about some of those things, the better it will be. Some jobs and companies and people are not like that. So I would urge and advise you to, you know, try and find one that is. I think being based in Chicago, we have a bigger opportunity to do that than people based in New York. I think the rat race in New York is tough. I think in San Francisco, it's probably even worse. But in Chicago, I think we do have the opportunity to do that. And technology enables the good and the bad. We're all sitting here. We've all probably got our phones. We've got our laptops in our bags. And that's the way that we survive. And we should use them for good and not let them take over our lives as much as possible. But it's hard. You know, we all have to admit that it's hard and figure out how it works for yourself. The way I run my sort of life and try to work with the people that work with me is to have principles. And those principles are things that you can stick to, you know, a lot of the time. Not all the time, but a lot of the time. So I just thought I'd share some of those with you. Some of them might seem flippant. Some of them are, you know, more serious, but it's the reality. The first one, never miss the family's birthdays. Really try to avoid being on a trip when it's somebody's birthday. If somebody, you know, if you can do this, I would take the kids with me if it's one of their birthdays and have them be part of my trip rather than miss out. It's not always possible, but as much as you can, try to do that. Never forget to pick your kids up from school or any activities. I mean, I am proud to say, sorry, if you can't hear me. I am proud to say that I have never left my kids at any event not picked up, and they're 12 and 16 now, so I think I've done a good job on that one. And never check emails and texts at mealtimes. And that's more of a lesson now for my kids, for them not to do it rather than me. I've learned not to do it. But there's got to be some sacred time that you're not addicted to those devices. And so I think, you know, definitely something to do. The next one, try to make the parent-teacher conferences. Again, not always possible, but prioritize that above most of your, you know, business meetings if you can do that. Try not to fall asleep on conference calls. And, you know, I admit I've done it several times. But if you do, say to people, sorry, I missed that. Can you repeat it? Or I remember being at a pitch in, Kelly, you'll laugh about this one because you know who I'm talking about. We were at a pitch and I'd flown to London. We'd worked all day. I don't know that I slept much on the plane the night before. And then we had a call with our global CEO at 10 o'clock at night. And we all went back to our rooms to do this call. It was a really important one. And I fell asleep. And people were texting me saying, she's asking you questions. And I woke up with the beep. And I said, I'm sorry, I fell asleep. Can you repeat the question? So, you know, it happens to everybody. But again, be transparent. She understood. You know, we're tired. We're traveling around the world. So, you know, don't worry about things like that. And, you know, the last one, we're all on conference calls all the time. Try to focus most of your attention on the call. And one of the reasons I do lots of my calls in the car is because I can't multitask on anything else when I'm in the car, which is great. You know, I laugh. My husband can multitask any time he's driving, but not any other time. And I can multitask any time except when I'm driving. But I think, you know, it's important. If you're on a call, it's probably a good reason, and you should try and focus your attention as much as possible for that, or miss the call. And then the last ones, don't sweat the flight delays. We all have been stuck at LaGuardia. We've all been stuck at O'Hare, JFK, you know, any long list of those. If you have checked the weather, you've checked, you know, when the flights are going to come in, and I'll show you in a second, many apps to help you do that. don't go to the meeting. I would prefer to be stuck at O'Hare and not be on a plane and be able to attend the meeting via conference call and go back home at night than spend all of my time just sitting on a flight at O'Hare or LaGuardia or stuck flying around. It's not always possible, but think about that. If you can't make it to a meeting, you know, there's other ways of doing it. Everybody has technology that can help you dial into the meeting some other way. Don't pretend that you don't have a life. You do. You have a life outside of work, and you know, probably your colleagues and clients do too. So, you know, acknowledge that. One of the things that we have as a rule as a family is if you are going to be entertained by anybody, you know, in the media, there's tickets for sports games and things like that. If it's outside of work hours, we're not allowed to go unless it's us and a kid. And that's the rule for my husband and I. So if, you know, somebody invites him to something, I won't go with him, but he'll take one of the kids, and then they start to get the benefits of the work that you do, and it means it's more meaningful for them there. So your clients will have kids, your colleagues have kids. Why not do something with them as opposed to doing it separate? And then these are some of the apps that helped me survive the madness. So you will see all of the different... So the Dial Meeting, if you haven't used that one, it's amazing. It goes through all of your meetings in your calendar, and then you hit one button and it dials in all of the codes and things like that. So if you're taking calls in the car, that's huge. And then teach your kids how to use it. So take notes, everybody, on this one. That's my favorite. I use that, you know, all the time. And you can, you know, use it at work as well. You just hit one button and it dials everything in. And then the Genius Scan as well. You know, instead of going to the photocopier and taking a print or figuring out how to do it, you just take a picture and then you can email it to somebody. So for filling in school forms and doctors, you know, medical forms for kids and dentist forms, perfect. Then the GoToMeeting and BlueJeans, great. Obviously Waze, I'm sure everybody knows about that one, uses that one. Flight Radar, it tells me where every plane is in the sky, what height they're at, what number it is, what time they're gonna land, where they are in terms of directions. So if you're stuck or you're waiting for a colleague or a husband or a kid who's been on a school trip, that tells you exactly where they are, so it's great. Then obviously all of the airline and the hotel ones. Turbulence Forecaster. I hate flying, I hate turbulence, and I'm on a plane every week, so I really like to know exactly when the bumps are going to hit and prepare myself for that. Yammer, I don't know if people use that, but it's a really good community device for schools, so we share information that way. And then the ones that help, you know, keep me sane, Fitbit is a good one there, and obviously Uber, so some basic ones. And then some confessions. You know, if you're on a conference call, it doesn't matter where you are. So do you know where I am on an ARF call? I could be at home. This is me at home without, nobody knows whether you've got makeup on or you've even got dressed at home when you're on a conference call. This is me on a call in San Francisco last year. And then this is me on a call using my flight app when I was on a plane, figuring out where all the planes are. So, you know, make it work for you. I think that's the big message. But be productive when you're doing it. So don't be doing anything half-heartedly. When you're in, and be productive. And when you're out, you're out. You're doing something with your kids or your family or something for yourself. I think that's the other balance that we sometimes forget is us. We do everything for work and for our kids and for our husbands, but we forget about us. So we need to do some of that too. Okay, thanks.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Kate. I'll remember that the next time we have our conference calls. Okay. So next up, I'd like to introduce Stacy Simmons, Senior Director, Customer Experience and Insights, Orbit/Expedia. You can tell us more about that. And I've known Stacy now for a couple of years. It's been such a pleasure. You have been on many committees, and you're just always willing to roll up your sleeves and help out, and I just really appreciate that. So I'm going to hand this over to you, and just make sure to hold it close.
Okay. Thanks, Rachel. All right, great. So really delighted to be here today. I do work for Orbitz, is a brand in the Expedia portfolio. And we were acquired about 16 months ago. So it's been very interesting kind of moving from one culture to another, but still, you know, kind of being in the travel space. And travel is, it's kind of good I'm in that space because I think it means my coworkers understand kind of what I go through every week. I'm gonna tell you a little bit about that. And then I'm going to to give you some of my best practices as well, and I think you'll see some of them actually overlap with Kate's. I am what's called a super commuter, and that is somebody who travels more than 90 minutes or 180 miles. In my case, I'm going from Madison, Wisconsin, every week. I travel about 150 miles or 3 hours each way to get to Chicago. Our office is here. The headquarters for Orbitz are here. The headquarters for Expedia are in Bellevue, Washington. So I also am going there occasionally. And usually I'm here for a few days a week. So I actually have a condo in the South Loop. So this is kind of what enables me to do this. If you look at kind of the numbers here, since I started to work for Orbitz in 2010, I've traveled over 32,000 miles just for commuting, and that doesn't include my overseas trips and domestic U.S. stuff, but that's kind of crazy to think about that. Some other numbers are all the forms of transportation that I take. I normally actually drive halfway, and then I take the Metro train into Chicago every week, but luckily I work in the Ogilvy building. So if you're from here, you know that is actually where the trains come into, and then I just go upstairs to the 10th floor, and there's my office. So it's actually pretty pretty convenient. I also love the Chicago City buses to sort of get around to get to my condo and back and forth, and then I'm flying all over the place too. So I am a big fan of all forms of transportation. And then my other numbers. So I have been through, over the past 6 years, at least 8 sets of headphones. I've been through 4 mobile devices, including a BlackBerry. May it rest in peace. I have had 3 work laptops. I've had 3 tablets plus a Kindle, and a mobile hotspot, and 2 Bluetooth-enabled cars. So this is all, and a partridge in a pear tree for this time of year. So it's been, my relationship with technology is very deep, and it's been long, all the way back to, every job I've had has had some version of all of these things, and I couldn't do my job and be connected to my family without them. So what are some of the apps or programs I can't live without? I'll start with the work ones, then I'll talk about the life ones, and then I'll talk about the ones that are kind of at the intersection. So in terms of work apps, these are the ones that I use most often. BlueJeans is a video conferencing program. You probably either love it or hate it. It's one of those things. But it does enable you to do voice calls as well as presentations and video conferencing. Concur for managing expenses. And really, I think apps have come such a long way in that you can do almost everything kind of on the fly. And sometimes it's even easier to do it that way than it is to sit at your computer for Concur. As I incur an expense on a trip, I scan the receipt and I put it right into my expense report. So it just makes it super seamless and easy. Duo is the way we connect to the company through our virtual private networking. Outlook, of course, has everything in it to just connect you to work. And then I actually use it's more of a website than an app, but it's called timeanddate.com. And it allows me to plan meetings in multiple time zones. So you can actually put in as many time zones as you need to, and it'll show you when are the kind of normal working hours that would work for everyone or not. We have offices in a big office in London. We have a big office in Sydney as well, so I'm always planning kind of meetings that have to accommodate those time zones as well as the central time zone in the Pacific. So this has actually been really a lifesaver for me. On the life side, Facebook. Simply put, I mean, it does allow me to connect with folks, especially when I'm traveling and on the road, and even with my family. Although I have to admit, I was the first person in my household to use Facebook. My husband uses it more than I do now. But it is a reliable place for people to able to find him. So it's actually been helpful for that. Pandora, just from a music perspective. And then I will be totally honest. These are also things that I use to, when I'm waiting in the airport or, you are waiting for a conference call to start. They are things that just help kind of put the fun into life as well. It's a great part of technology. And then also Netflix, because I'm on the road so much, it has been something that I've been able to catch up on lots of shows, which I never ever have time to watch any type of television. So that is something that has really been helping me. And yes, I do binge watch as well. So And then the things that are really at the intersection are the ones that I think really are the glue that kind of holds my life together across these multiple places and activities that are always going on. Google and sort of the Google ecosystem has really enabled me to, I think, tie things together in a really seamless way. So the calendaring, you know, it's such a simple thing, but having a calendar that I can share with other people, with a babysitter, with my family, with other organizations that I'm a part of, it has just made it so much easier to be able to stay connected and organized through all of this. Connecting, obviously, Gmail when I'm going on a trip, that the trip is in Gmail and it will go onto my calendar automatically. I mean, that is just a huge time saver for me. And then things like Evernote, I kind of call that like my hard drive, because it stores all of the, you know, just random lists and ideas and things that I collect. Every conference I go to, I make an Evernote list of all the things I've learned, and then I can go back to those, and I've been using it for now, I think, 7 years or 8 years. So I have this, you know, really nice kind of compendium of so many things that I've learned and things I need to capture. It's great for packing lists for trips for my family. I have a warm weather packing list and I have a cold weather packing list that I have for my kids. And I tell them, here are the things you need with the little check boxes. And I just update it slightly, but I don't have to reinvent the wheel every time we go somewhere. So I keep that in Evernote as well. And I have to put a plug in for Orbitz because it is something that what I like to do is anybody like a fan of rewards, travel rewards kind of programs? Well, what I do with Orbitz is I travel for business and I can earn rewards through our Orbitz rewards program, and I apply them to leisure travel. And I've traveled enough, and I was just looking at this last night. So I have the Orbitz rewards program has been around for like 3 years, and it basically you earn a percent back and you get dollars that you can use toward hotels. I've actually earned $1,700 to put towards hotels just by virtue of work travel. So it's pretty amazing that's the case. And you, through Orbitz, I have been able to do that. So it's kind of awesome that I can benefit in that way. And then just my advice on technology, you know, I think there are a couple things that it's great to use technology for. I think you've seen some of the things I use it for. You know, communication, just straight communication, you know, who is where, when, and what do we need to get done is kind of the most basic form of it that, you know, obviously we're using our phones for, and Outlook and, you know, email and chat, you know, programs. Organization, I don't think I could do what I do with two households, two children, you know, locations and travel without this organizational kind of system that I have using technology. And then also connecting. And this goes beyond communicating. This is, you know, how do I, you know, make sure I'm there for the people that I love, my friends, my family, and my coworkers as well. And so that connection piece is really important to me, to feel like I'm connected no matter where I am. And then, you know, I would also say, you know, don't forget to spend time offline as well, completely disconnected. I think, you know, meals, there are just a lot of cases where the device really can interfere with sort of the quality of your interaction with other people. Sometimes it enhances it, but not always. And so, you know, I think always keeping that in mind, that you need to make space and time that's when you're not connected to technology. And finally, I would say, just remember who you're doing it for. You know, whether it is, you know, your family, your friends, it's just at the heart of everything I do. And I do agree, too, that you need to have a bigger purpose in your job, and that's very important. But for me, this, at the end of the day, this is who I do this for. So that's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Stacy. Appreciate that. And next up, speaking of the Google ecosystem, we have Kelly. It's a perfect segue, actually. And Kelly's head of brand strategy at Google here in Chicago. We met today for the first time, but we work closely with your colleagues and love them.
Thank you. Just curious, how many moms do we have in the room here today? So about a third, maybe, right? So for those of you who don't have kids, I apologize, but maybe this gives you a little sense into what's to come for you as you think about work-life balance and managing your career and managing your life outside of your career. So having worked in digital marketing since 1996 and now working at Google, a technology company, obviously I love technology, but I think what's at the epicenter of this issue for us is really the mobile device, right? Was looking at some stats earlier today, and hard to believe, but I think most people that have a smartphone never leave it further than 3 feet from their body at any given time, right? How many women sleep with your phone by your bed? Use it as your alarm clock? Yeah, yeah, that happens. And we check it like 200 times a day. I mean, that seems obsessive, right? So maybe there's an issue there. Maybe we have a work-life balance, but I don't think technology is the problem, right? I think we have a choice problem and we're not making the right choices, right? As Kate said, balance doesn't exist, but however you define what your life is going to be is your choice, right? And you can have control of your life, or you can allow the inertia of the chaos that exists in your work spill over into your personal life each and every day. So I think the biggest thing we can do as women, because once you're married and have kids, you're going to realize it's never going to be balanced. As great of a husband as you have, and I have a great husband, he's never going to do 50%. He's not. Right, Kate? Right, Aparna? Yes, yes, we know this. You can leave. I'll take your rebuttals later. So it's really about choice, ladies. And I think the biggest thing we do is we don't make that choice, right? You've got to ask yourself the hard questions, right? What are your goals in your life, right? What do you really want to do? And that doesn't mean with work. It means in your life. Like, what do you want to look back when you're 70 and say, I am so glad I did that? What are the experiences you want to have? Where do you want to live? What are the friendships you want to have? And then what are the priorities that you're going to hold sacred, that you're not going to break, like Kate's principles? What are those things? And then importantly, once you can define those two things, you can really establish roles and responsibilities, right? If you're single, if you're a single parent, if you're married, if you've got kids, your roles and responsibilities are all going to change based on your goals and your priorities. But the most important thing you need is to create those for yourselves. And I got to be honest, I did not have these for a long time, right? It wasn't until my 30s when I got pregnant with twins and thought, oh my God, how do women do this? How do women do this? And if anybody's worked at Leo Burnett, there's a woman there named Lisa Gillis. Anybody know Lisa besides Kate, maybe? She has twins a few years older than I do. So I sought her out and said, Kate, my God, how do you do this? How does this work? What does this look like? And she shared this philosophy with me, and I'll share it with you today. And that is really this notion of, in life, if you want a successful family, you need to embrace this idea of an A job and a B job. Neither one are more important, but they're fundamentally different, right? When you're young, you have no kids, no house, no responsibility, it's really easy to have two A jobs, right? Jobs where you're working nonstop, you're able to go into the office. Yes, I can go to London tomorrow, right? All those things that are endless yeses. Once you have kids, the endless yeses kind of stop, right? Or they at least have to stop for one of you. So her challenge to me was, you gotta think about balance in a different way, and you've gotta think about it as a unit, right? So what are you and your husband gonna do together? They're gonna make this work. So thank you to Lisa. And I guess the way I've thought about it beyond this is really this fundamental question is, do you live to work or do you work to live? And my answer, honestly, is obviously in the middle. Those are two extremes. But at different points in my life, I've done both of these things, and that's okay. Again, it's all about your choice. And I'll just share my little quick timeline here with you, just so you can see how this has evolved for me over the course of my career. So as I, you know, start from out of college, not a care in the world, maybe some student debt, you know, just up. I'm doing the Sheryl Sandberg, I'm leaning in, I'm moving up, working nonstop, right? And then your kids come, right? You're like, holy cow. What am I going to do? Something's got to give here, right? I've got to figure this out. So in all honesty, my husband and I had that conversation, like, how are we going to make this work? What ended up happening is he went back to school. We both worked in advertising. He went back to school and got his master's in education and became an art teacher. So critically important job, but stable, predictable. He wasn't flying to London tomorrow without any notice, right? So he was kind of our bedrock of our family that really enabled me to have the A job, right? So together we created the balance, right? And that's my challenge to you, because the reality is things happen in your life, right? So we had a great 12-year run. Things were going great. We had great balance. And then 4 years ago, my husband was diagnosed with cancer.
And that clearly, test, test. Cancer kills everything. I mean, what's going on? That's a really bad joke because he sadly died. But I share this with you guys not because I want your sympathy, but I want to say, like, bad things are going to happen in your life, right? And good things. You're going to have deaths. You're going to have births, marriages, divorces, losing jobs, gaining jobs, dealing with sick and dying parents. All of these things are going to happen, right? But what that made me realize, right? We had a great balance going on here. But for me, my responsibilities changed. My roles changed. Our family dynamic changed. So I could no longer have that A job. I had to get a smaller job. And as Kate said, you know, it really looked at, first and foremost, can my current employer give this to me? And the answer was no. As much as they wanted to, they couldn't. So I needed a different job, a smaller job that was more stable, more predictable, that allowed me to really refocus on my family and my new roles and responsibilities that it afforded. So what I guess I would ask you to think about in summation is really two things. It's the notion of choice and the notion of change. Choice is the most important thing, ladies, honestly. You've got to know what you care about. What are your goals? What are your priorities? And then what are you going to do, whether you're independent or part of a partnership with a husband, a spouse, a partner, right? What are you going to do to make that work? And then last but not least, right, is this notion of change. Life is going to throw you some unexpected curveballs, whether they're happy or sad. You've got to constantly reevaluate your goals, your priorities, your roles and responsibilities so that you can ultimately have a happy and successful both personal life and professional life. Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly. Thank you. Important choice and change. Is that Tina back there? Come on down. Okay. So the last of our quick presentations, in the meantime, I'll make sure that that other mic is working in case this one doesn't for some reason. Tina Manikas is joining us. Thank you. Hello. Nice to meet you.
Between you and the end.
Well, or between you and the break. Yes, yes. So president of FCB, RED, RED, and we're just happy to have you here. And take it away.
Terrific. Thanks. Just little things. All right, have to get that right. Hi, everybody. How are you? Sorry, I found out I was doing this like a few days ago, so I probably could have packed this in a little smaller suitcase, but I'm gonna go for it. Oh, hold it closer so you can hear. Okay, I got it. So I thought I'd talk about what I packed on my journey to work-life balance because I've been in this business for 30 years. So started out as a receptionist slash bookkeeper at an agency in Chicago, and if pretty does. You know, held every role possible. It was really interesting when I was working and going to graduate school, I thought, oh, this is so hard. I had it so easy when I was just working. And then when I had my first child, I'm like, damn, it was so easy to go to school and go to work. Now this is hard. And then I had two babies. I'm like, oh shit, one baby? That was nothing. Two babies, this sucks. And then I had three, and I finally realized, you know what? I have it so good, and I am so blessed, because there's always someone off with a worse situation. Just telling you, it's just a life lesson for me. But anyway, when I thought about this, the journey to work-life balance, I really believe it is about the journey and not about the destination, because the destination, I don't know if any of you love movies, but I love movies. You give me a superhero, fantasy, et cetera movie, it kind of it mirrors life a little bit, or at least what I want life to be. But I always think about this movie, which many of you will not have seen because you're too young. But let's put it back. Let's see. Am I going the right way or am I going backwards? Of course I'm going backwards. Okay. Well, I don't know where I'm at. I need my slide. No worries, but I'll tell you what it is. It's a slide of Brigadoon. Has anyone ever seen the movie Brigadoon with Gene Kelly and Sid Charisse? Well, it's about two jaded guys from New York that decide to make a trip to Scotland, and they stumble upon this village, which is just a beautiful village that is harkens back to olden times, and guy meets girl, falls in love with girl, but this village only appears in life every 100 years. Okay? And that's a little bit about if you're thinking the destination is work-life balance, it's really about what you do along the journey because there is no perfect perfect thing. So I just love Bigadoon, and hopefully you've got it there. There we go. Love my little picture. I need my little clicker. Are you going to click it for me? Okay, we'll see how well you do. Okay, so go forward. So I hope I'm not being redundant, but I know I will be, so there you go. But this is life right now. We're 24/7, and a lot of people say that tech has made it more about work encroaching on your personal life. But I will say that tech actually has made social and personal life encroach upon your work life as well. It's a two-way street. You're never really off, and you can more easily respond to people in your personal life as well as your work life in either place you are. So you kind of have to think about that. And if you go on, so I believe work is part of your life. Okay, work is part of your life, and that's why you have to be able to love what you do. And if you're not loving what you do right now, you have to figure out how to get to a place where you love what you do. Whether it's the current job and things you have to twist around you, or you have to get to a new job, I really think you have to love what you do, because it's just about life balance. It's not, to me, work and life balance. And I've been around many years, and I can just tell you, because today more than ever, can't just shut it all off. So just going on, I thought I'd share with you kind of the things I packed on my journey to that work-life balance place. And I'm going to share with you 15 things, because it gets me in the express lane in the grocery store. And I'm all about that. I even turned the UPC codes facing out, because I want her to go like fast, or him. Anyway, so let's start with number one thing. First thing I packed is a spirit of compromise. And I think it's the ability to negotiate with yourself and make a deal with yourself with the best intentions in mind, right? Because there's no Mr. and Mrs. Perfect in this world. It's just about knowing that you've made a compromise and you're good with it, as well as sharing that with folks around you. I think also it's the second thing I pack is the ability to shift priorities. And you might have read about this, but people go through what some people call seasons in their life. So if you're 20 to 25, that's one season of your life. And sometimes then women go into this part of their life, 25 to 35, where it really becomes difficult, right? You know, what are you going to do? You're going to have kids. How does that impact work? Work impact kids, et cetera. But I think that's when especially you have to figure out that things shift in priority. And I think I heard the previous speaker called it an A job and a B job. But I really do think if you do have a life partner, that it's how you compromise together. I don't always call it A job and B job. I just think, for instance, I'm a late night person and I'm in an agency and it's gonna be late, more often than not. My husband, he's morning and his job starts very early. And it helped us really compromise. And I know that kind of sounds euphoric, well, that's nice for you, but it did work out and you know we kind of made it happen. Third, I love this guy. I believe quality time trumps quantity. And when you're in on something, you focus 100% on that person. So if I'm at work, I'm really focused and I give it my all. But when I'm at home and I'm helping my son with a paper, okay, I do that, help him with the paper, but I'll be there till 2 a.m, 3 a.m, helping him with that paper. Because for him, I'm giving him 100% of my attention. You know, it's not like, oh, I'm too tired. I worked so hard today. I have to try to pick, but also focus and make it more about the quality versus the quantity. And, you know, I'd love to make it to every game of every child, but sometimes you have to compromise where your significant other or another family member or another friend try to make it to most, but some I'll miss, and I get that, but we make that compromise together. And it sounds better in retrospect than when you're going through it. I get it. I do believe you have to pack a belief that you will succeed. A lot of this is very mental, you guys, you know? When you think something's impossible, it becomes that. And I'm sure many of you have employees or you have peers, and when you give them a belief that you believe in them and they'll succeed, then they somehow do. And I do believe that you have to, you know, the power of positivity that you are doing it well, you're not screwing it up, that really matters. This is a strange slide, but I love Waze app. I don't know if anybody talked about Waze app yet, but I love this app, but I think it's a metaphor for your work, your life roadmap, right? Because it's a great map for flexibility. It kind of gets you where you want to go and how to spend your time and how to manage your schedule. I love it because you're actually using other people's information, right? Your circle and the folks that kind of impact socially on that. You take detours and routes that might not be perfect, but get you there faster. So thinking about the tricks in life are just as important as, you know, you kind of learn from others from experience versus you stumbling through yourself. Which brings me to the next thought, which is a good mentor matters. These are two of my mentors. One is from the past and one is very current. Yvonne Firth used to be the head of FCB, CEO in Chicago, and she actually wrote a book, very interesting title, The Yoga Mat to the Corner Office, so check it out. But she's wonderful. She was always a great listener, and sometimes you don't need someone to give you the answers, you just need someone to listen to you, right? And then somehow you feel good that you've accomplished something, and she was an awesome listener and a kind of putting things in perspective. And Susan Cradle, who I think was going to be here originally, and she apologized for not being here, but she's my newest friend. She's such a dynamic person. I will say the one thing I see her do day in, day out, she definitely is one that loves her work. And she works to live and lives to work. She loves it. And she does not, what she believes in and her point of view, she channels in every part of her life. She doesn't have a different mommy persona from, let's say, a family persona to a work persona. And that's, I think, pretty, has integrity, has integrity with it. Anyway, and then your circle of friends. When I had my first child, I was downtown Chicago. Really cool, right? I made the choice to move to Palos Hills. I moved to Palos, why do you think I moved to Palos Hills? Because the property was appreciating? No. No, my mother-in-law and father-in-law were there, and it was the way I thought I can lead my agency life and have a home life of a way that I could have a circle that mattered. And I know many of you probably don't have the luxury of a mother-in-law you love, maybe, or a mother-in-law that's close, but it's like the neighbor matters, the friend matters. You have to make those connections of people that you trust to help you even walk the dog when you're not there or when you travel. So I'm sure you know all about this. Eighth thing, are you having lost the will to live yet? Are you good? Are you with me, you guys? All right, this is good. This is good. Okay. All right, good, because I thought, you know. Anyway, the eighth thing I packed with me is a commitment to make them part of your life. So it's very tempting to feel guilty and to overschedule, if you have children, your children's lives with every kind of sport, every kind of activity, because that makes you feel like, wow, I'm a better parent. Sorry, I just figured that out. Okay. But I really do believe you have to be very choiceful with that, because very rare of your kids, I know they're all gifted, but very rarely will they continue to make a career of those things in life. And I prefer you say no to some things and bring them with you to the restaurants you go to, not Chuck E. Cheese's, but your restaurants. Let them grow up like gentlemen and ladies, and remember your life, how, you know, the cultural moments and the moments you make as family matter that are distinct to you versus you're chasing what everybody else is doing. So it's just an interesting thing for me that I think when I look back, it's like some of that stuff I could have cut out, you know, and I did, but not all of it. I think some folks might have talked to you about tech. Okay, tech, I think, hinders but also helps in some ways. I talked about ways. Buy online, pick up in store, pretty love it, really love it, saves me time. Having integrated calendars, I don't care, I shamelessly use my work calendar for everything. I don't care at this point who sees what I do. If they don't like what I do, then I shouldn't be there anyway, right? I don't care if they see I have something on there. A thin everywhere laptop, I'm loving that because it's just important and it's sleek and it just, you always feel like you can always turn to it if you need it. All my devices are connected, so I don't have to worry, like I get home, oh shit, I forgot that thing. And, you know, if you ever need it, you have it. I'm not saying go work at home, but you have it. And then I just love FaceTime and texting and being able to connect with my family and see them live. I just think that's the best thing. And I have family in Europe, which I never got to see before, and I'm like, wow, I can see them age like me. Anyway, and then I discovered iBooks. Because I love to read, and then I never read. enough. And then I was a voracious reader because of iBooks. So I travel a lot for work. I travel globally and then in the US. And I loved it, but then I kind of wasn't in the moment. And then I discovered, next one, if it comes, audiobooks. It's fantastic. But there's two components. You have to have a good narrator as well as a good book. But I love it when I'm driving to work. If you hear, see me with an earphone, I'm probably listening to some cool book because I get to now enrich myself when I want to. And it's very discreet. And I just think it's the best thing. I know some people love like the hard book, but I don't have that luxury. So I use this. And then again, that's just part of those key personal compartments you need to bring with you, right? If you're into gardening, or if you have a way you want to savor life, whether it's taking a walk, you got to keep doing those things. That's important as a person to feel like you're on that journey to work-life balance, whether it's physical activity or just an exploration for yourself. And me time, I strongly encourage self-care because I'm taking care of aging parents right now, and it's a bitch. It sucks. It's really horrible, and I think sometimes it's because those parents work so hard they didn't have time to take care of themselves. And so the more you take care of yourself, it's not selfish, it's better for your children in the end. So please make those appointments for yourself. And I think you see I'm not very quiet, but an energetic attitude, if you don't have it, try to have it, because a lot about it is, you know, your family and your work can see you. And energy is a big deal. You got to play hard as well as work hard. It's really important. It's kind of that same notion of being in the moment when you're in the moment. And a lot of times I just gamify things. So, you know, if a meeting can end 10 minutes early, I've won, right? If I start a meeting with a purpose statement, so everybody knows what we're doing, we get out of there, I've won. If I make dinner under 30 minutes, I've really won. And 13 is the word no. I know somebody said it before, but I love this quote. Almost everything will work again if you unplug it for a few minutes, including you. So I just love that quote. But you can be kind, but you don't always have to be nice, right? And telling somebody, I have to leave today by 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock, that's okay. Say it, and then people will plan around you. And then two more. 14 is character. I really believe in laughter and hoping that you live in an environment that promotes good fun and laughter, because you've got to be able to have fun and laugh at yourself and laugh at others, and patience and independence. And at the end of the day, independence means your own POV on your own balance is the only thing that matters. Don't look to others that judge you on your work-life balance. It's dangerous because they don't know, and it'll make you feel bad. And you don't have time to feel bad. Really, you don't, and you don't need to. So, and the last thing is just things to leave behind. I think email does not equal texting, okay? It's not as important as a text. I don't think email is as important as a call or face-to-face. I don't know if some people just live their lives by emailing back and forth when they could just get up and talk to you. It's really annoying. Reply all emails, don't do it. Email notification, don't turn it on, I don't. You know, when I check email, I check email. I don't need to hear a ding every time my email goes on. And then Sunday night, I know some people plan their week Sunday night, and then they send out all these emails Sunday night. I hate that. I really start Monday, not Sunday. And that's it. Kind of, I think, I hope you find your Brigadoon, but have fun getting there.
Thank you, Tina.